Great. So we've been holding strong now at around 30 people. So I think this is a good, better time than any to start. My name's Edwin Kaplan. I'm the violist of the Tesla Quartet. Thank you all so much for joining us for this exciting second week of our Bartók journey together. We're going to be looking at the second string quartet this week. And we've got our open rehearsal coming up on Friday at 1 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, and our performance on Saturday at 7:30 Eastern Daylight Time. But tonight we have a very, very special guest, Mark Steinberg, first violinist of the Brentano String Quartet. We have known Mark for a number of years now, and I've heard him speak about a number of subjects. And every time I hear him speak, it's always, always enlightening, both intellectually and emotionally. So I'm sure you will all very much enjoy what he has to say. So without much ado, I'm just going to turn things over to Mark, and we'll get the conversation going. Mark, take it away.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, guys, for having me here. Thank you for everyone who's spending time listening to what I have to say, and for joining the Tesla Quartet in getting to know these pieces. And you're in great hands with them. I know they're going to give some really beautiful and insightful and exciting performances. It's great that you can be there with them for that. So just to talk a bit about Bartók in general at first. He was a rather shy, introverted person, a little ill at ease in society. And he, of course, became, besides being a great pianist and a great composer, a great ethnomusicologist. And he started to, as probably many of you know, collect folk music. And he went into villages all over Eastern Europe and into Africa, which we'll get to a little later, to live in villages with people and get to know the music that was part of their culture and part of their everyday lives. So this was music that was useful to them in expressing what they were going through in their everyday lives. And this was incredibly moving to him. He was there with the Edison wax cylinder, and he was a sort of scientist collecting all these folk tunes as objects to study and to classify. And he felt much more at home when he was traveling than he did in his actual home. He felt more at ease, more at peace. He felt more connected to the people around him. So it was very important for him personally, also in terms of trying to find a way to express himself. So there's a famous quote from Oscar Wilde where he says, "Man is least himself when he talks in his own person. Give him a mask and he will tell you the truth." And I think in some sense, Bartók was looking for a mask to wear, not to disguise himself, but to give himself a way in which to express himself more directly, not necessarily the way he had been trained or the music that he had received directly in the Western classical tradition, but going back to some basic building blocks of what made music expressive and meaningful. He sort of took on a costume for a while, until he formed himself to that costume and learned to speak in that language directly. So it became very much a part of him. Here are a couple of quotes from Bartók about his time collecting these melodies and tunes and what they meant to him. He says, "Peasant music actually is nothing but the outcome of changes wrought by a natural force whose operation is unconscious in men who are not influenced by urban culture. The melodies are therefore the embodiment of an artistic perfection of the highest order. A melody of this kind is a classic example of the expression of a musical thought in its most conceivably concise form, with the avoidance of all that is superfluous." So he found there some very kind of archetypal, direct musical gestures that he could make his own in a way that he could reform into new thoughts. He was learning the language directly. And about this, he said, "It is a matter of absorbing the means of musical expression hidden in the peasant melodies. Just as the most subtle possibilities of any language may be assimilated. It is necessary for the composer to command this musical language so completely that it becomes the natural expression of his musical ideas. And in fact, Bartók did this so successfully that there are many times in his music where it's very difficult to tease out whether, you know, until we find the direct evidence, whether this is a folk tune that he's lifted entirely from having heard it somewhere else or having recorded it, or whether it's something of his own devising that uses some common musical elements or common musical gestures with that. So when he went, he collected all these folk tunes, then he categorized them and he put them broadly in two categories. One was called the tempo giusto style, which is basically the dance music, which is fairly regular rhythmic. And the other, very interestingly, he called the tempo rubato style, which is a sort of freestyle. And this was more directly related to speech rhythms, going in and out and having a very natural flexibility according to the rhetoric and the expression of the moment. So just to start thinking about that a little bit, we may have some people here who speak Hungarian, but for those of you who don't, I'm going to play you just a little bit of a poem in Hungarian just to start to get a sense of the music of that language, because of course every language has its own music.
Szélkele most, mint sízszerekél a csarnok elontott, oszlopi közt levegő rém alakinte felé. S mondd, honfi, mit ér epedő kebele romokormán, régi kor árnya felé visszamerenni mit ér? Messze jövendővel komolyan ves összve jelenkort. Has, alkos, gyarapíts, s a hazafény.
I would like to put next to that a recording of Bartók speaking in English. This is just a few seconds of him speaking in English, but to me, it's I don't notice right away that it's English. It kind of sounds like Hungarian to me.
This sonatina was originally conceived as a group of Romanian folk dance for piano. The three parts which Mrs. Bartók will play were selected from a group and given its present title of sonatina.
I don't know if anyone else feels the way I do, but it really has the very classic inflections of Hungarian. And of course, one of the rhythms that's very prevalent in the language that people talk about a lot and that we find all over Bartók's music is a short note with an accent and a long unaccented note, the da-dum, da-dum, da-da. That is a sort of characteristic of the language. And very early on, but when I was in college, I had the good fortune to play the second Bartók sonata, and there was a wonderful Hungarian violist who was at the concert and started talking to me afterwards about it. And I asked if I could come and play for him, and he agreed. And he explained to me something that I've never forgotten about these rhythms in terms of how to perform them. He said that most non-Hungarian musicians play this rhythm with the wrong character. And that it basically, he explained, it comes from a good place, that we know the rhythms are in there and that they're important, that they're characteristic. And he says everyone overdoes them, that the short note has too strong an accent and it's like we hammer it home. But he said the most important thing to do as a performer to get this rhythm to feel right, it has to do with the space that you make before you say the short note. So there's a sort of lift, and he explained it by saying, it's like you create a little hole that you can drop the accent into. So you go, da-da, da-da, da-da. And I've found that incredibly helpful in playing Bartók ever since, and gives it a sort of elastic and propulsive quality, which is really beautiful. It's also, I think, a big part of Bartók's writing for all instruments, but maybe I'm prejudiced because I'm a violin player, but maybe most especially for strings, that there's a way of playing as if we're speaking syllabically. And there are some musicians who worked with Bartók directly. I mean, not to speak of, I will play, the next recording I'm going to play has Bartók playing the piano along with someone else. But there are many recordings of Bartók playing piano. He was an incredibly wonderful musician, very free and very, with a lot of integrity and character. What I'm going to play for you is the first of a group of Hungarian folk tunes that he arranged for violin and piano. And he's playing here with the great violinist Josef Gingold, who was one of his closest collaborators, who knew Bartók very well. They played many concerts together. And this first of the folk tunes has always been one of my favorite things, because there's not much that I've ever heard that feels like it's so directly speaking syllables through the violin. Oh, whoops. Sorry, I should be more organized. I know it's here. Here we go. There are more of those, and they're equally wonderful. But that seems to me such a direct way of speaking syllables that are varied and flexible and direct through the instrument. And there's also a very special usage of the bow, which is sickety, but is also, I think, comes from peasant music and ways of using the violin in that music, which is, I have my violin here. This sort of what we call, sometimes we have a lot of sort of off the string playing, what we mean that the bow comes off the string, comes on the string. But there's a lot in the peasant music with a stroke that doesn't leave the string, but has an incredible elasticity. This, which allows us to have a kind of syllabic inflection, which is really wonderful. And I want to play you just a little bit of a contemporary gypsy band that still is upholding this style a little bit. And you can hear it, I think, quite clearly. It'd be fun to listen to more of that, of course. And I'll put next to that a recording of one of the violin duos. Bartók wrote a set of 44 duos for violin. If you don't know them, I really recommend you play them if you're a player, or go listen to them, because in some ways they're a sort of glossary to Bartók's works. If you know all those 44 duos, you've encountered pretty much all the language that comes into the quartet in a simpler form most of the time. They're sort of in the spirit of the six books of Microcosmos that he wrote for the piano, which are for children to learn the language of music and how to speak language. And the violin duos work very much that way too. And if you get to know them well, you have a sense for the grammatical units that Bartók uses in almost all of his music, really. And so this is one of those, and this is in a recording by the great violinist Sándor Vig and Alberto Lisi.
Mm-hmm.
I'll stop it there. But I think you get again that sense of immediacy in the inflection. Another, one more thing to talk about just in terms of the style of performance of Bartók that's maybe interesting is that somehow Bartók's music has become something that people consider to be very rough and heavy a lot of the time. And in fact, he uses the word ruvido in the quartet sometimes, which means rough, and there are rough edges. But overall, this sense that I was talking about with the da-dum rhythm, this elasticity and there's a sort of buoyancy in the rhythm is a huge part of his way of expressing himself. So I'm gonna play for you back to back just a little bit of the second rhapsody for violin and either orchestra or piano. I actually have one of each here, but the first, they're both wonderful recordings, but they really show the two polar opposites in the way of approaching Bartók music. So the first recording is the violinist Isaac Stern. He's playing with orchestra, and you'll hear the first way that I was speaking about, something that's quite heavy and rough and rooted. And the second recording is the violinist Zoltán Zsekai, to whom the piece was dedicated and who also premiered the second violin concerto. And that's also a piece that has become something very different from what it started out as in terms of performing style. And you can actually find on YouTube the recording of the very first performance of the second violin concerto. And it's wonderfully rhapsodic and buoyant, really. But I'll just play these two examples back to back, and I think you'll immediately see what I'm talking about. That's enough of that. And here's now Zsekai playing. I think that's enough already to hear the difference between them. One with a sort of heavy hammered stroke and one with a good deal more elasticity. And Bartók, actually, there's a letter that Bartók wrote to Zsekai complimenting him on how well he played this piece. And he said, "You really understood it. You played it like a peasant." And I think that's probably true. And that we really hear that kind of bow stroke that I was talking about. It doesn't leave the string and doesn't hammer on the string, but lifts the rhythm out somehow. So now I'd like to move to talking more particularly about the second quartet, which is possibly my favorite of the six quartets. So I don't know if the Teslas knew that, but I was glad that they asked me to talk about this one. I know that many of you just heard the first quartet. This one is a really different world. This is, I think, although there's a lot of what became mature Bartók already in the first quartet. This, between the first and second quartet, I think there's really a sharp turn toward something that is very recognizably Bartók's language without so many roots in the past as we hear in the first quartet. It has much tighter organization than that very sprawling piece. And it has an interest that stayed with him always in very small motivic ideas. And I'm gonna speak particularly about something even smaller than that in a way. Once he got into the third, fourth, fifth quartet, we get into the world where he's more interested in, or very interested in games and contrapuntal intricacies and reflections and sort of Bachian cleverness. That's not so in evidence in the second quartet. There's really a sense of direct dramatic flow, narrative flow that goes, it's unlike some of the arch forms that we get later that have a sort of architectural feeling. This one, there, you know, particularly, of course, the fourth and fifth quartet, we have this sense of what we call an arch form, and things balance each other on each side of the piece. This piece is definitely unidirectional. It's going somewhere the whole time. And it's sort of, we get that a little bit in the last quartet in a slightly different way in the sixth quartet. But there's this really inexorable unfolding where everything that happens in the piece is already there in sort of an embryonic form in the very first phrase that you hear in the piece. And it starts to blossom and move in different directions. It's a little bit like when you get a Greek chorus in a Greek tragedy. And this piece absolutely, for me, has the form of a tragedy. And I'll speak about that more specifically in a moment. But you know, often the chorus comes out and they have a prophecy. They say, oh, this will not end well. And somehow we know this will not end well when this piece starts already. It has the sense of prophecy in a way. This piece ends up in a very bereft and very barren place emotionally. I remember when I studied for 3 years with Robert Mann, who was the wonderful first violinist of the Juilliard Quartet for 51 years. And he told me that early on with his quartet, he was playing the second quartet. And at that point, he, and I think maybe the whole quartet, they were very heavily involved in Reichian therapy, where the orgone box and all that, and getting rid of what Reich calls the armor around, so making yourself open and vulnerable to everything. And he said during that time, they gave a performance of this piece. And when they were playing the last movement, he started just uncontrollably weeping, and he could barely play because the feeling of it is so raw and so direct, and he was so open at that moment to receiving that. So during one of the periods when I was working on this piece myself and thinking about it a lot and wanting to write about it a bit as well, I had been sort of trying to let inside the shape of the piece and what it did and how it moved. And during that time, I happened to go to a performance of a play I've seen many times, King Lear. And when I was watching King Lear, I got very excited, and I suddenly had this, what felt to me like a revelation. Of course, it's not truth, it's my invention, but that the second quartet of Bartók is very much parallels the arc of King Lear in many ways, in that it has a sort of setting of conditions in the first movement, a fixation on certain ideas and certain elements that are going to prove essential and true as the work unfolds. It has in the second movement a storm scene, just as wonderful as the storm in King Lear. It has a place for the role of the fool, who of course is also very important in King Lear, and then the inevitable, really preordained tragic downfall that comes at the end of the piece or at the end of the play. And it feels like a very, very similar dramatic arc to me. So at the very opening of this piece, which I'll play in a moment, we have basically, I'm gonna get a little technical here and hopefully it will make some sense. We have a line that's more or less made up of only two intervals. Now, it was very common for Bartók to get fixated on intervals, which is just the distance between two notes. So, and we just count how many notes are in between. So if we go from this note to this note, that's a second, because that's the next note. Here, if we go, that's a third, and that's a fourth. And the first tune that you'll hear that comes in the first violin is made up of, at first, only fourths. So, right, over and over. And that fourths are not what are the world of harmony before Bartók is mostly built on. When we start to stack them up and make chords out of them, the feeling is usually of something a little bit unmoored, unstable, or not tethered to any particular pole. And that's important in this piece. And it, in my personal interpretation, don't think this has anything to do with Bartók directly. I have no evidence that it does. That feels like King Lear a little bit. This feeling of being very open and not going to float from place to place. But after we have the beginning of that, we have this minor third. And that is going to come in very important ways throughout the piece. And in my little fantasy scenario, that represents Cordelia, who is, of course, the daughter who truly loves him and who he casts away and only realizes his mistake at the end of the play. So I'm going to play the beginning of a recording of that just so you hear that tune and you can have a sense of what I'm talking about. Sorry. Here we go. That's how it starts. It's sort of innocently enough, but the seeds of everything that are about to happen are already there. I'm gonna go forward to a place a little bit later where, just to give an example of how you hear the speaking rhythm that I was talking about, it's very direct here, although it comes up all over the place, really. There, that's a very clear example of the ta-da-da, and you hear how they do it so beautifully. The ta-da, ta-da, and they give it space to sink in. By the way, all the examples I'm playing now are from a recording of the Hungarian quartet, and the first violin is Zsekai, who you heard playing the second rhapsody a little while ago, and they work very closely with Bartók. All right, and we'll play a place later. Remember I talked to you about the minor third that I in my scenario represents Cordelia, right? I'm gonna play a place later where he makes a whole tune out of sort of filling out the minor third. And you'll hear that tune in a really, it's a very sweet, it's very open, and you have underneath these sort of open fifths, which are a sort of drone that we hear often in peasant music. And it gives, I think, a sense of distance and nostalgia around this. But this is the next sort of version of what he does with that interval, where he sort of gets fixated on it. That tune will return again. I'm gonna skip ahead to a part that, the first movement that we call the recapitulation, which you don't have to know much about, except that it's very common in movements of the form that this one takes, that the opening material returns at a certain point. We have the sense of homecoming, but that doesn't happen in this piece. There's a moment that we label as the recapitulation, where we expect the beginning to come back, but it's a very changed beginning version of that tune at the beginning. And if you remember what I said, that minor third, you'll hear that that's now missing. It's been taken away, which goes very nicely along with my analogy of King Lear, because Lear has cast Cordelia aside, and now we only have the intervals of the fourth. And it's a very different kind of lonely feeling than it is at the beginning. At the beginning, it's much more tender, I think, anyway. So it doesn't really matter whether you hear or not, but this is all fourths, all the other interval that I was talking about, and the contrast has been taken out, it's been removed. That third though, that came in the other theme, da-da-dee-da-da-da, gets worried over a lot in the movement. The climax of that is when everyone speaks it together in a very powerful way that's followed by silence that really makes it feel like something that you no longer have, but that you're yearning for. And then it returns as a sort of memory, very distant. And in fact, that's the last idea that we're left with in the movement in a way that's very, very bereft for a movement that starts with such a sense of hope and possibility and goes through so much. It has an incredibly kind of stark and difficult emotionally ending. I'll just play the very ending for you. It's incredibly haunting. See, I can imagine Seraphine playing that really great. It's gonna be terrific. From there, we go into what I called from Lear, the storm scene. And this second movement is based on music that Bartók collected when he went to Northern Africa, specifically to Algeria and a region called Biskra. And he was very taken with the drumming that he heard there. And that found its way into this piece, also into the fourth quartet. And he really uses the string instruments almost as a kind of percussion. I'll play you a little bit of the beginning of that. It's like Lear in the Storm. It's wild and elemental and a little bit brutal. And you'll also notice that there's the Hungarian quartet does, I think, a fantastic job of really evoking two different kinds of bow strokes. We were talking about on the string and off the string before, and you'll hear they have a sort of for the drum music, but the other part is not like that. Often you'll hear people, but they don't. That has a more speaking quality in their performance. So that's something I think interesting to notice in the layering of the quartet texture. Very exciting. You're going to have to come to the quartet's performance if you want to see what happens next. So later, as I mentioned before, there is the role of the fool, which is, of course, is very important in King Lear. The fool also, I mean, it's maybe interesting that in Shakespeare productions, apparently there's some debate as to whether people usually had the same actor playing Cordelia and the Fool. But the Fool is Lear's companion and jokes, but always tells the truth in a way that's very painful, but that he gets away with because he's joking. And we hear that kind of character in this movement as well. So I'm going to play you a section that that has that character. And you'll also hear this kind of drumming figure from the beginning starting to disintegrate and disappear. And this is like reality kind of dissolving around you. And that of course also happens in the storm scene in Lear, where he puts everyone in his life on trial. But of course, none of them are the real people, but he believes that they are. He starts to see other worlds. And then I'm going to just play for you the kind of very extraordinary ending of this movement. I have to say, as a quartet player, as a first violinist, it's thrilling to play someone and get someone else to play this for me, because it's a little bit terrifying, this ending, especially I think for the first violin and the viola. But it is this, it's a sort of obsession over, it winds up being an obsession over the minor third idea, as if Cordelia, the minor third, whatever, however you want to think of it, has been taken away and becomes this obsession you can't let go of. And it's actually how the movement ends, kind of with the polarity of these two notes in the minor third against each other. There we go into the third movement, which is really the tragic conclusion of the piece. And a big part of the expression of this movement is the idea of lament, which of course I was interested at one point. I found out, which I had never considered, that in many cultures, and even today in many cultures, there is a profession where you can be a professional lamenter. And this is when, if people, for whatever reason, because it's not considered dignified in the caste that they're in, or for various reasons, they can't express their grief, they will hire someone to give form to their grief and sing it as a sort of catharsis, which I think is an incredibly beautiful and powerful idea. And that is the tenor of this last movement when we arrive here. I'm gonna play you just a little bit, very briefly, of some examples from other very brief examples from other composers of the idea of lament. So here's always with this descending figure. Here's Mozart. Okay, that's all for now. here's an example from Bach. Now from a sort of inheritor of Bartók's language, this is Ligeti. Always these descending lines, kind of wailing. It's like a kind of keening in some cultures. All right, now I want to play the lament from the last movement of this piece. You also have at the same time as this, when this lament first comes in, you'll hear this, again, the minor third that I keep talking about, this interval. You'll hear that and on the bottom in the lower two strings as the lament is starting. And it's another kind of musical depiction of grief, this kind of tolling, marking time. I know I'm running later than I should, so I'm just going to play one more example, which is the very end of the piece. And this, I told you, you heard that minor third on the bottom as a sort of tolling. You'll hear there are a number of places in this movement where you feel a kind of heavy tread or a kind of tolling that comes in. And the very, very end of the piece, the last thing we hear is exactly that third in the lower two voices, just with no really very little resonance, just as like almost like a nail in a coffin. And just for the last analogy with King Lear, I was interested to read actually that there is one version, one of the folios of King Lear, where the very last words of the play, which is not what's usually performed, but the last words of the play there are with Lear holding his child Cordelia in his arms. And she's dead now, and he realizes that she loved him all along, and he's cast her away. And the last words he says, "Look here, look here." And that's really very, very much what the very ending of this piece feels like. It's with the kind of inevitability of the tragedy that's occurred, it has an incredible weight and darkness to it.
Thank you.
time a little more. So, and really the entire piece has a trajectory and arc toward this moment. And it's the drive of it and the organic feeling of going through it as a dramatic arc is incredibly strong and deeply moving, I think. So you're all very, very fortunate to get to spend time with this piece. We all are. Me too.
Wow. What an amazing. I really love this conceit of King Lear. This is something I've never heard before, and it's a really beautiful way of expressing the narrative of this piece, and the way you brought us all the way to the end. It's really incredible. Wow, so this has been incredibly fascinating. I hope, let's see if there's anybody in the Q&A who wanted to comment on what we've heard so far. Let's see, Gary Knapp says, if Bartók played with a softer style and preferred others to play in that style, how did the very rough mid-century style come to dominate? How do these things change? Oh, this is a fascinating question. Mark, do you have any thoughts on sort of the evolution of style and how from generation to generation, it's almost like, Do we forget how to play the way, or I mean, what is it that drives that evolution?
I would say, first of all, that although I've presented this as it's really wonderful to find out how Bartók might have expected this to play or how he would have wanted it to be played, I don't think it's a closed question whether or not it's important to keep that style. Or whether there might, I mean, actually it's funny, in music, I feel like we're less open to these things. In theater, you know, people stage Shakespeare plays in contemporary contexts with, you know, in places they were never conceived of and shed a different light on it. And I don't think there's any particular reason we shouldn't be able to do something similar. So I'm not meaning to imply that there's only one way to play these pieces. I do think the world gets noisier and we look for more ways to cut through that. I do think that my teacher, who I loved so much, who I brought up, Robert Mann, I think the Juilliard Quartet had something to do with this, because they, early on, they started giving performances of these quartets that had incredibly high energy and were a little rough around the edges. And I mean, not exclusively, but had a real kind of forceful drive, and they were very successful with that. And they trained a lot of quartets, and that became something that was sought after. But at the same time, Zsekai, who was the first violinist of the Hungarian Quartet, who we were listening to, took up residence in Banff, where we've all been together, and lived in Lloyd Hall for years and years in this sort of dormitory. And quartets from all over the world used to go travel to Banff in Western Canada to play for him and receive his wisdom on Bartók. So the tradition was kept alive that way. Of course, we have all these recordings. It's wonderful that we have the chance to hear so many people who are directly connected with Bartók, because I think it informs how we read the music. You know, I was talking about different strokes on the string, off the string, but we have dots in the score, and we think, oh, this means one thing. But then we go and listen to people who played with Bartók, and we realize, well, maybe there's more latitude there. Maybe it can mean there's a whole range of meanings for these markings.
Interesting. Yeah, we heard from Dr. Biraud last week that Bartók was sometimes not as specific as he could have been with his notation, because he knew that the people playing his music would take some things for granted. And actually, Dr. Biraud was sort of lamenting that there's not a critical edition yet of the complete Bartók quartets for that reason.
Yeah, there's also, I mean, even what I was talking about in terms of playing on the string, off the string, these kind of strokes, we have lots of letters from Bartók where he's pleading with people to please keep your bow on the string. Please don't play this off the string. You know, for the concerto orchestra, or there's a famous letter to Max Rostal where he talks about these things. So we know at the same time that people around him were starting to play a little differently and that he was looking for something very specific.
That's fascinating. And Ross, did you also have something you wanted to say on this topic?
I don't know if I do, or if I told you I did and I've forgotten.
Oh, I see. You just put in the chat that you were going to answer, but
I meant that we actually just answered that question.
Got it.
I'm just cleaning up the chat.
It's beautiful. We have another wonderful question from Jennifer Orson, who asks, was Bartók inspired or influenced in any way by the visual art movements of the time? And I believe that there was a little bit of discussion last week about the Cubist influence. And I mean, I don't know, Mark, is that something that you notice in his music, or is it something that you know about his music to be?
No, I have no knowledge of this directly. I mean, I can see, you know, in Cubism, of course, you can see an image from all different sides, and there are many places in the quartets where you have these sort of reflections and these contrapuntal interweavings of a line with itself, which is maybe a little reminiscent of that. But I have no
idea. I think that was sort of the gist of it, that there was this multi-perspective view on a subject, which sort of an emancipation of perspective in a way, which I find fascinating. It's a wonderful question. Yeah, I think it's funny that when people sometimes we'll play Bartók in a concert and we'll get comments from people afterwards. Oh, I really loved your Brahms was so beautiful. But that Bartók, it's so challenging. I don't know if I'm quite there with it yet. And I always try to remind them that, you know, we have a lot of context for understanding his music already from the art that was around him. I mean, we already look at Picasso and we already look at these things, and it's something that we have a sense for, and we also have a sense for movies from the time. So I think if people have a hard time sort of grappling with Bartók right away, it is helpful to look to the visual art that was around him or the film that was around him to sort of get inspiration for maybe absorbing it in a way that is understandable.
And particularly this quartet.
Go ahead, Ross.
In terms of the context, he was writing this quartet in 1915, 16, 17. No, I suppose knowing that and the kind of desolation of the third movement, I suppose you could see as in a way a response to the catastrophe of the First World War. And it may or may not be a response to it, but knowing that somebody lived through that and that musicians and artists tend to reflect their environments, that's another lens to, you know, to kind of take a look at this piece of music as well.
I think it would be shocking if that had nothing to do with it. And also just personally for Bartók, the war meant that the Hungarian borders were closed. Mm-hmm. And so all these, the traveling that he was doing to collect this folk music, which was so important to him personally, was no longer possible. And he was shut. He was shut in Hungary and just had to sit with that by himself and was, I think, feeling the lack of that very profoundly and feeling very lonely that way.
I think that's something that we can all relate to in our current
moment. Exactly. You were talking earlier, Edwin, about the perception of Bartók, and I wanted to read the comment that Beth made in the chat, and I think it's very, very interesting and thought-provoking. She's saying that growing up in Pittsburgh, we were fortunate to have the Duquesne University Tambritzens based there, They were a music and dance group that preserved and performed the folk music of most Eastern European countries in authentic dresses and costumes. This music is so reminiscent of these performances. And what I was inspired by reading this comment was this idea that there is, of course, music that is considered to be folk music purely, you know, played by folk musicians in perhaps an authentic tradition. And then, of course, as in a sort of different camp, there is a so-called classical academic music, which is very, you know, sometimes a little bit rigid. And what's interesting about Bartók, in my view, is that he beautifully merges these two. He is deeply rooted in the tradition of a classical music and you know, in terms of his harmony, in terms of his form, and yet he is so curious about the music from his research that he did, you know, across all this folk tradition. So I was curious, Mark, to ask you, have you found this this kind of position that Bartók occupies in the world perhaps contributing to the fact that he is a little bit of an outsider, and, you know, he could be a little bit of, you know, he wasn't really respected as much as he deserved during his time. It sounds like he's still a little bit misunderstood. I was curious if you would like to speak a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, I think he probably felt that way. I think it's interesting, you know, because folk music had been part of what we are calling classical music for a long, long time. But most of the time it was sort of an exoticism, a flavoring or an accent, or it was a symbol of something, like Schubert or Brahms used the sort of the gypsy music to evoke a very specific stereotype that meant something to them. But Bartók went in and really wanted to understand it in a very deep way. And I think that pulled him a little bit away from the tradition he had come from. I mean, as you know very astutely pointed out, he's using forms and techniques that come from his predecessors, but he's layering on top of that a sort of different dialect. And I mean, just like we have sometimes unfounded prejudice against people who speak in certain ways with certain dialects, maybe he experiences that a little bit too, that the surface of it doesn't look like what we're expecting a certain caste or a certain level of society, and people use that as an excuse not to take him as seriously. But I think I'm sure we're all in agreement now that his music is as profound as music can be.
Excellent, excellent. We also have another question here. I think it was sort of discussed a little bit in the beginning, but it's just basically, this is a curious listener wanting to know if Bartók wrote music for concertos for solo instruments, and Mark already mentioned both concertos for violin and orchestra, violin solo and orchestra, and but also piano concertos. There's even a viola concerto that was constructed based on Bartók's music. So there's definitely quite a bit there. And an interesting comment from Rick Spratley, who pointed out that the folk ensemble, the Hungarian folk ensemble, Muzsikás, who plays a lot of traditional music, but also familiar tunes that we know from Bartók, had released folk versions and concert versions of Bartók's duos, which I find fascinating.
That's where, yeah, we heard one of their examples tonight.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, they're a great group.
And you're in luck because next week's guest is Daniel Hamar, who is one of the founding members of Muzsikás. So he will have his unique perspective on all of this, having actually spent his career performing a lot of this music and really living with it and studying it too. So,
excellent. Yeah. Well, that's great. I'm Rick Spratley. I hope you'll join us next week to hear from Muzsikás directly. Let's see. We have a comment from Hyunji Chung. Hello, Mark. Thank you so much for your wonderful talk. this is the piece I studied and played at Taos right before you arrived 2 summers ago. Oh, that's wonderful. The question I have is, why would you think Bartók would want to be so specific with tempos? It has the effect on the page, to Hyunji, of partitioning off or dividing sections from each other. This is a great question. I love this. Mark, what do you have to think about this?
Well, I mean, for one thing, he was very clear about the fact that these were suggestions. And he also gives, I can't remember if it's in this piece, he gives durations also for sections of the music. So he's trying to pin down certain parameters that will point us in the right direction. But people are very fond of pointing out that Bartók does not always slavishly follow his own metronome markings. And he didn't expect other people to either. And in fact, with the second quartet, it's very complicated because he gave one set of tempi and then he gave another one later. And so there's a lot of confusion about which ones are the correct ones. But, I think as with all music, the correct ones are the ones that connect with the emotion that you're feeling in the rhetoric of the music. And so I think the process of what a performer needs to do is to, I mean, yes, I understand on the page, it does look like there's this and then there's that and then it, right? And we're always having to switch, but finding your way of speaking the music so that when you get to a certain section and you understand what you're about to say, you could only possibly say it in the tempo that already happens to be indicated on the page. So it's not that you have the idea of the music first and then decide the speed, but that the emotion brings the tempo that you're looking for. And part of the process of learning the piece is negotiating your internal space so that when you arrive somewhere, that's how you need to speak it. It just happens to be how Bartók already wrote it.
This is a chicken and egg sort of way of looking at things.
Yeah, I really like that answer you gave, Mark. That's fantastic. Just want to share, if you can see it, this is from the fifth quartet, and at the end of the whole score, this is a madness, absolute madness of each section, the duration that he indicated. When I first saw it, I was just stunned by that. Just want to share that.
Yeah, but I mean, I think in the end, we can see it as a path toward liberation rather than enslavement somehow.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, you said it right. Right. I think, is there more questions?
I think we've basically managed to answer most of the questions here. So this is a better time than any to maybe sort of draw the discussion to a close and take this opportunity to thank our wonderful guest, Mark Steinberg, for an amazing, amazing discussion, so full of interesting observations about the music, but also, your willingness to share your ideas and thoughts is always, always welcome here. And we can't wait for the next time to speak with you. I'll say to everybody watching that we will have an open rehearsal on Friday where we'll be playing portions of this piece and working through it, and hopefully we'll have had some time to absorb some of these things that Mark has been saying, and then on Saturday at 7:30 Eastern time we'll be giving a live performance broadcast on YouTube. If you sign up. If you register for the event through our website, you will get all of the links and emails. These are all private links because we want our audience to feel like they're getting something special. We also have a very exciting raffle. We'll be raffling off this wonderful poster by Andrew Crust. He's a conductor and artist, and he's done this. He's designed a custom designed poster for each week with an excerpt from each quartet on the poster. And of course, this week, I'll say that we've been, the Test Quartet has been working hard to put this together for everybody. And so this week, we are sort of sponsoring this week ourselves. And so where if anybody feels so inclined to support what we're doing and to support the continued efforts of this amazing project, Go to our website. There's places to donate. There are ways to make tax deductible donations. But if you go to our website, we can easily direct you. There's a donate button there. If you feel like you like what you see and you want to see more content from us in the coming weeks. So thank you all so much for attending. Thank you, Mark Steinberg. And thank you to my colleagues in the Tesla Quartet. I hope you have a wonderful evening. And we look forward to seeing you all at the open rehearsal on Friday at 1 p.m. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So much.